Good morning. Let's consider ideal fluid flow through a circular pipe which decreases in diameter.
Flippin' physics.
The streamlines showing the direction of the fluid flow are shown in the figure. Remember, in ideal flow, the fluid is non-viscous and incompressible, and the flow is laminar and irrotational. Assuming there are no losses of fluid in the circular pipe, the mass of the fluid flowing through plane 1 must be the same as the mass of the fluid flowing through plane 2. To be clear, the only way this could not be true is if the fluid were collecting somewhere in the pipe. This is not possible because the fluid is incompressible. Okay, because these masses are masses of fluids flowing through a plane, let's identify these masses as delta M, where delta M represents the amount of mass which passes through each plane during change in time delta T. Bobby, what is the equation for density?
Density equals mass over volume.
Correct. However, considering our mass is delta M, the amount of mass which passes through a plane during change in time delta T, Bobby, what should the volume be?
That would be delta V, the volume of the fluid which passes through a plane during change in time delta T.
Yes, Bobby, thanks. And let's solve for the mass which passes through plane 1 during change in time delta T. It equals the density of the fluid at plane 1 times delta V sub 1, the volume of the fluid which passes through plane 1 during change in time delta T. Now, during that change in time, delta T, the fluid will flow through a displacement delta X. Bo, please use the equation for average velocity to solve for the displacement of the fluid delta X through each plane in terms of velocity and change in time.
That's just average velocity equals displacement over time. Solve for displacement, and you get displacement 1 equals velocity 1 times change in time 1. And you can do the same thing for point 2. Displacement 2 equals velocity 2 times change in time 2, right?
Almost.
The change in time for the mass going through each plane will be the same, so you do not need subscripts 1 and 2 on the changes in time. It's just delta T.
Okay. Yeah. Right.
Yep. Now, the volume of the mass flowing through the pipe in time delta T equals the cross-sectional area times the length of that volume of mass, delta X. Substituting in our equation for the displacement of the fluid through plane 1, we get that delta capital V sub 1, the volume of the fluid which passes through plane 1 during change in time delta T, equals the cross-sectional area of plane 1 times the velocity through plane 1 times change in time.
Mr. P?
Yes, Billy?
Do we really have uppercase V for volume and lowercase v for velocity in the same equation?
Yes, Billy, unfortunately we do.
Oh, that's too bad.
Yeah, please be careful of that. And substituting back into our equation for mass, we get that delta m sub 1, the amount of mass which passes through plane 1 during change in time delta t, equals the density of the fluid at plane 1, times the cross-sectional area of plane 1, times the velocity of the fluid through plane 1, times change in time. And because there are no losses of fluid within the pipe, all the mass that passes through plane 1 will eventually have to pass through plane 2. And therefore, during the same change in time, the same amount of mass will have to pass through each plane. In other words, the mass which passes through plane 1 equals the mass which passes through plane 2. And we can substitute in the equation for which we have just solved for the mass which passes through each plane to get the density of the fluid flowing through plane 1 times the cross-sectional area of the pipe at plane 1 times the velocity of the fluid through plane 1 times change in time equals the density of the fluid flowing through plane 2 times the cross-sectional area of the pipe at plane 2 times the velocity of the fluid through plane 2 times change in time. And
everybody brought change in time to the party.
Everybody brought mass.
And we can be equitable and we can take change in time from everybody. And that means that the density of the flowing fluid times the cross-sectional area of the pipe times the velocity of the fluid all at a specific plane equals a constant value. This is called the continuity equation of fluid flow. Billy, please determine the units for this equation.
Absolutely. The units for density are kilograms per meter cubed, The units for cross-sectional area are meters squared, and the units for velocity are meters per second. So the units for this equation are, well, meters cubed cancel out, so it's just it just works out to be kilograms per second.
Well done, Billy. The continuity equation of fluid flow states that the mass flow rate of a fluid in an enclosed space is constant. And let's take a moment to recognize this is an important term, mass flow rate, which is the mass of the fluid which flows through a plane per second. And it equals the density of the fluid in the plane times a cross-sectional area of the plane times the velocity of the fluid flowing through the plane. Okay, but realize we are specifically talking about ideal fluids, and ideal fluids are incompressible. That means the density of ideal fluids remains constant. And if the density of the fluid does not change, it can be removed from the mass flow rate equation.
Everybody brought density of the fluid to the party.
Not really. Yeah, you need to calm down.
I'm not being too loud.
It's like, uh-oh.
You need to just stop.
Okay, now that we've removed density from the mass flow rate equation, that gives us the continuity equation of ideal fluid flow, which states that the cross-sectional area of a plane times the velocity of the fluid flowing through that plane remains constant. And Billy, what are the units for this equation?
Well, that is cross-sectional area in meters squared times velocity in meters per second, and that works out to be meters cubed per second. Does that mean that the continuity equation of ideal fluid flow is a volumetric flow rate?
Yes, Billy. The continuity equation of ideal fluid flow states that the volumetric flow rate of an ideal fluid through an enclosed space is constant. And again, let's take a moment to recognize that this is an important term, volumetric flow rate, which is the volume of the fluid which flows through a plane per second. And it equals the cross-sectional area of the plane times the velocity of the fluid flowing through the plane. But realize, because the average velocity equals displacement over change in time, and cross-sectional area times displacement equals volume, we can also express volumetric flow rate in terms of volume. In other words, volumetric flow rate equals the volume of a fluid which passes through a plane during a change in time, divided by that change in time, and it equals the cross-sectional area of the plane times the velocity of the fluid flowing through that plane. And volumetric flow rate of an ideal fluid through an enclosed space remains constant.
And now we have uppercase V for volume and lowercase v for velocity in the same equation.
Oh boy.
Yeah.
Not again.
Now, taking a moment to go back to our example of ideal fluid flow through a circular pipe which decreases in diameter, when I add highly idealized fluid particles to the illustration, notice what happens with the velocity of the fluid as it moves from plane 1 to plane 2. As the diameter of the pipe narrows, the continuity of volumetric flow rate means that, because the cross-sectional area decreases, the velocity of the fluid flow must increase. And we can see that mathematically if we solve for the velocity of the fluid flow through plane 2. It equals the quantity cross-sectional area of plane 1 divided by cross-sectional area of plane 2, all multiplied by the velocity of the fluid flow through plane 1. Because cross-sectional area 1 is greater than cross-sectional area 2, cross-sectional area 1 divided by cross-sectional area 2 is greater than 1, and that means the velocity of the fluid flowing through plane 2 is greater than the velocity of the fluid flowing through plane 1. And you can see that happening in the animation of the fluid flowing in our narrow pipe.
Hey, that's what happens when you put your thumb over the end of a hose, right?
Exactly, Bo. If you have a garden hose with water flowing out of it, you could put your thumb over the end of the hose to decrease the cross-sectional area and therefore increase the velocity of the water flowing through the end of the hose.
Oh, right. And you can see that the water flowing out of the hose where you have used your thumb to decrease the cross-sectional area at the end of the hose is moving faster because that water has a larger displacement in the x direction in projectile motion.
Yes, Billy, that is correct. And thanks, Bo. This is a simple way anybody can demonstrate the continuity equation of ideal fluid flow. That the volumetric flow rate of an ideal fluid remains constant. Clearly, once the fluid has left the garden hose, the water is no longer constrained to the garden hose and the continuity equation of ideal fluid flow is no longer valid. However, it is valid in the garden hose all the way up to and through the plane at the end of the hose where the water enters into projectile motion, which can make for fun extension problems combining fluid flow and projectile motion, so we have that to look forward to. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoy learning with you.